From New York, this is Democracy Now!
We must not lose focus on what the real job is. And with that being said, it's time to move forward with the criminal charges because she deserves that and much more. So please continue to say her name. Breonna Taylor.
The city of Louisville, Kentucky has agreed to pay the family of Breonna Taylor $12 million, more than 6 months after police shot and killed the 26-year-old black emergency room technician in her own apartment. It was one of the largest settlements even ever reached for a black woman killed by police. We'll speak to Michael Denzel Smith, author of the new book, Stakes is High, Life After the American Dream. Then Israel signs a U.S. broker deal to normalize relations with the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain.
This day is a pivot of history. It heralds a new dawn of peace.
He deserves to win the Nobel Peace Prize. We'll speak to Palestinian-American attorney Noura Erekat, who says these are sham deals that will boost oppression in the Middle East. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The city of Louisville, Kentucky, announced Tuesday it will pay the family of Breonna Taylor $12 million and institute a slew of reforms to the police department responsible for her death. This more than 6 months after police shot and killed the 26-year-old black emergency room technician in her own apartment. Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher announced the historic settlement at a news conference with Breonna Taylor's family. Attorney Benjamin Crump welcomed the agreement but demanded the criminal prosecution of the officers who entered Taylor's apartment with a no-knock warrant and killed her March 13th.
We still are demanding that Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Cameron bring charges immediately against the police officers that murdered Breonna Taylor. Immediately, this week, justice delayed is justice denied.
As part of the settlement, Louisville named a dozen changes to how its police department will operate, including more oversight from top commanders and an early warning system to identify police officers accused of excessive force. We'll have more on the police killing of Breonna Taylor after headlines. The United States reported over 1,400 coronavirus deaths on Tuesday, the highest daily total in over a month. The U.S. death toll is nearing 196,000. During a town hall event hosted by ABC Tuesday, President Trump repeated his claim the coronavirus will go away.
We're going to be okay, and it is going away, and it's probably going to go away now a lot faster because of the vaccine. It would go away without the vaccine, George, but it's going to go away a lot faster
with it.
It
would go away without the vaccine?
Sure, over a period of time. Sure, with time, it goes away.
And many deaths.
And you'll develop herd mentality. It's going to be herd developed.
President Trump appeared to be referring to herd immunity. Epidemiologists don't know how many millions more people would need to be infected for the United States to reach herd immunity, or even if herd immunity is possible for the novel coronavirus. By one count, adopting a herd immunity approach could lead to the deaths of over 2 million people in the United States. Meanwhile, the New York Times reports there have been over 88,000 cases of the coronavirus on nearly 1,200 college campuses around the United States. On Tuesday, Louisiana State University head coach Ed Orgeron said he was confident his team, the defending college football national champs, would have another successful season because so many players have already contracted COVID-19.
I think most of not all of our players, but most of our players have caught it. Yeah, hopefully that once you catch it, you don't get it again. Now, I'm not a doctor, you know what I'm saying? I think they got that 90-day window. So most of the players that have caught it, we feel that they're going to be eligible for games.
LSU has confirmed over 750 COVID-19 cases in the month since students returned to campus. The Department of Labor's Occupational Safety and Health Administration is facing criticism for fining a JBS beef plant in Greeley, Colorado, under $16,000 after six workers, all immigrants, died at the plant from COVID-19. Nearly 300 workers became infected. One family of a dead worker described the small fine as a, quote, huge slap in the face. Last year, JBS reported over $50 billion in revenue. Meanwhile, ProPublica has obtained emails showing the text of President Trump's controversial executive order keeping meatpacking plants open during the pandemic was based largely on language written by the meat industry. The number of confirmed coronavirus cases in India has surpassed 5 million, the second highest in the world after the United States. India reported over 90,000 new cases and nearly 1,300 deaths over the past 24 hours, bringing the nation's overall toll to over 82,000. Despite the surge in cases and deaths, India is continuing to lift restrictions across the country. On Monday, India's parliament opened for the first time in 6 months, but 25 lawmakers could not take part in person after testing positive for COVID-19. In the Gulf of Mexico, Hurricane Sally strengthened to a Category 2 storm this morning as it slowly came ashore near Gulf Shores, Alabama, with sustained winds of 105 miles per hour. Forecasters are warning of extreme life-threatening flash flooding, with up to 30 inches of rain possible along parts of the Gulf Coast from southeastern Mississippi to the Florida Panhandle. Sally's part of a record-shattering hurricane season, with the forecasters currently tracking 7 tropical disturbances across the Atlantic. In the western United States, air quality alerts remain in effect for huge swaths of California, Oregon, and Washington, as thick smoke from record-shattering wildfires continues to bring some of the world's worst air pollution to tens of millions of people. Forecasters are hoping cooler temperatures and calmer winds will help firefighters get the upper hand on containing the blazes. Over 5 million acres have burned. At least 35 people have been killed by the fires fueled by the climate crisis. In immigration news, a Cameroonian mother who says she was involuntarily sterilized while held at the privately owned Erwin County Detention Center in Georgia might be deported today. Pauline Bynum has lived in the United States since age 2. She's been detained at the Immigration and Customs Enforcement prison for nearly 3 years. Last fall, Bynum was reportedly subjected to invasive surgery on her reproductive organs without her knowledge. Bynum's looming deportation comes as whistleblower Dawn Wooten, who was a nurse at Erwin, has detailed how the jail performed hysterectomies on prisoners without their consent. Human rights advocates have condemned the disturbing practices, saying forced sterilization amounts to genocide. In related news, a key witness in an ongoing investigation into sexual assault and harassment allegations at an El Paso, Texas immigrant prison has been deported. The 35-year-old woman from Mexico had recently told her lawyer several guards forcibly kissed her and at least one touched her intimate parts. She's one of at least 3 people who've come forward about the systematic sexual violence at the ICE jail. The Department of Homeland Security's Office of Inspector General launched a probe into the accusations after ProPublica and the Texas Tribune first reported them last month. Israel signed a U.S. broker deal to normalize relations with the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain. President Donald Trump presided over the White House ceremony with the 3 countries on Tuesday. Trump spoke before a crowd of several hundred people on the White House lawn, most of them sitting in close proximity without wearing face masks, prompting concern from security for Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who joined Trump for the ceremony. Neither Netanyahu nor Trump mentioned the Palestinians in their remarks. Earlier in the day, Palestinian activists in the West Bank and Gaza protested the agreements. We'll have more on the Bahrain-UAE agreement with Israel later in the broadcast with Palestinian-American attorney Nora Erekat. In more news from the Middle East, President Trump admitted Tuesday he wanted to assassinate Syrian President Bashar al-Assad in 2017, but did not go ahead due to the opposition from then-Defense Secretary James Mattis. Trump made the admission on Fox News.
I had a shot to take him out if I wanted, and Mattis was against it. Mattis was against most of that stuff. He'd keep you in military, but he didn't know how to win.
Investigative journalist Bob Woodward first reported on the assassination plan in 2018, but Trump claimed at the time the story was false. This comes as fallout continues from the U.S. assassination of the Iranian general Qasem Soleimani earlier this year in Iraq. Unnamed U.S. officials recently told Politico the Iranian government is weighing an assassination attempt against the U.S. ambassador to South Africa in retaliation. Iran has denied the claim. On Monday, Trump warned Iran that if it took such action, the U.S. response will be, quote, 1,000 times greater in magnitude. NBC News is reporting the Pentagon's been unable to corroborate press reports that the Russian government had paid bounties to the Taliban to kill U.S. soldiers in Afghanistan. General Frank McKenzie, the commander of the U.S. Central Command, said, quote, it just has not been proved to a level of certainty that satisfies me. New details have emerged about how the Rochester Police Department spent months attempting to cover up the death of Daniel Prude, a black man who died from asphyxiation in March after police officers handcuffed him, put a hood over his head, and pushed his face into the freezing cold ground for 2 minutes while they kneeled on his back. He was naked. Newly released internal documents show the department spent months attempting to block the release of video of the incident. In one email in June, the department's deputy chief opposed releasing the video because it, quote, could create animosity and potentially violent blowback in the community, unquote. The police chief responded, saying, I totally agree. Police also attempted to frame Prude, who'd been suffering a mental health episode. In one police report, an officer wrote in red letters, make him a suspect. On Monday, Rochester Mayor Lovely Warren fired the city's police chief, saying there's a, quote, pervasive problem, unquote, in the city's police department. On Tuesday, the Rochester City Council passed bills to authorize an independent investigation into Prude's death, to transfer some money away from the police department, and to repeal a previous vote to fund a new police station. In Lancaster, Pennsylvania, at least seven people who were arrested Monday during protest over the police shooting of 27-year-old Ricardo Munoz are being held on $1 million bail. Body camera footage shows a police officer shooting Munoz, who is holding a knife. Munoz's family said he suffered from schizophrenia and paranoia. A House committee has condemned Boeing and the Federal Aviation Administration for their roles in the two fatal crashes in Ethiopia and Indonesia that killed all 346 people on board 737 MAX planes. A report by the House Transportation Committee finds, quote, the crashes were the horrific culmination of a series of faulty technical assumptions by Boeing's engineers, a lack of transparency on the part of Boeing's management, and grossly insufficient oversight by the FAA, the pernicious result of regulatory capture on the part of the FAA, unquote. Ahead of the 737 MAX crashes, Boeing's former CEO, Dennis Muilenburg, famously thanked President Trump for giving airline companies more latitude to regulate themselves. For the first time in its 175-year history, Scientific American magazine has endorsed a presidential candidate. In its new issue, the magazine's editors backed Joe Biden for president, writing, quote, the evidence and the science show that Donald Trump has badly damaged the U.S. and its people because he rejects evidence and science, unquote. And in Chicago, over 4,800 hospital and university workers with the University of Illinois Hospital System are in the third day of a strike, demanding safe staffing levels, better pay, and more personal protective equipment amidst the pandemic. 4,000 unionized workers have been working without a contract for the past year. This is Diane Palmer, president of SEIU Local 73.
We're going to keep fighting until we get everything that we deserve. UIC counted us out, thought it couldn't be done, but we're proving them wrong every day. And we're going to fight to make sure people get better wages, better working conditions, safe staffing, and PPEs for everyone.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by my co-host Juan Gonzalez at home in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, we're beginning today's report in Louisville. more than 6 months after police in Louisville, Kentucky, shot and killed 26-year-old black emergency room technician Breonna Taylor in her own apartment. The city announced Tuesday it'll pay her family a historic $12 million settlement and institute a slew of reforms to the police department responsible for her death. Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher announced the news at a press conference with Breonna Taylor's family.
This settlement includes a payment to Breonna's estate of $12 million.
The mayor also named a dozen changes to policing in Louisville, including more oversight from top commanders and an early warning system to identify police officers accused of brutality. The settlement is one of the largest amounts to ever be paid for a black woman killed by the police and comes after the summer uprising in defense of Black Lives Matter. Breonna Taylor was made a household name throughout those protests. But the officers who entered her apartment with a no-knock warrant and killed her on March 13th still have not been criminally charged, despite the demands of the family. This is Breonna Taylor's family attorney, Benjamin Crump, speaking during the joint news conference with the mayor of Louisville.
It has been so long getting to this day where we could assure that Breonna Taylor's life wouldn't be swept under the rug like so many other black women in America who have been killed by police, marginalized. So I'm grateful to the actions of the city of Louisville today. And it is not just the historic $12 million settlement, which, as I understand, is the largest amount ever paid out for a black woman in a wrongful death killed by a police in America. And Lanita, I believe it may be the largest amount ever paid for a black person in a police shooting. We're still trying to verify that. And it is certainly, Tamika Mallory, one of the largest amounts ever paid out for any person in the way of settlement in a police killing in America. This is about setting a precedence. When my great co-counsels from Kentucky, Lanita Baker and Sam Aguiar, first talked to me about this black woman who had been killed in her own apartment by this no-knock warrant, they were very concerned that nobody cared. Nobody cared about this black woman. Nobody cared about Tamika's baby. And that's when I started calling everybody I know to say that black women's lives matter too. I was saying to anybody who would listen, Breonna Taylor, life matters. And Senator Kamala Harris was the first national elected official to go on national television and to say her name, Breonna Taylor. With what has happened today, Mayor Fisher, not just with the historic amount, but equally important with the reform that Attorney Bacon, Attorney O'Connor spoke of, it sets a precedence for other black women that their lives won't be marginalized, that they will be valued. Lives like Sandra Bland, lives like Pamela Turner in Baytown, Texas, lives like 7-year-old Ayanna Stanley in Detroit, who also was killed as a result of a dangerous no-knock warrant. Because we have to speak truth to power when we get an opportunity. And these dangerous no-knock warrants are disproportionately executed against black people in America. And so I'm very happy that the Metro Council also stood united with Tamika Palmer to pass Breonna's law to abolish these dangerous no-knock warrants, because it was foreseeable who was most being put in danger with these no-knock warrants. While most of America is dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic, we in Black America are not only dealing with that pandemic, but we're also dealing with the 1619 pandemic. The pandemic that started 401 years ago when the first enslaved Africans came to America. And from that day to this one, we have been dealing with systematic racism and oppression that have killed us inside and outside the courtroom. We still are demanding that Kentucky Attorney General Daniel Cameron bring charges immediately against the police officers that murdered Breonna Taylor. Immediately. This week, justice delayed is justice denied. The city leadership has done a significant step today, but now it is on Daniel Cameron and the Attorney General of Kentucky's office to bring charges, and at the very minimum, Lanita, second-degree manslaughter charges. Breonna Taylor is a light to help heal what's happening in America. And for all those young people, those celebrities, athletes, but most importantly, the people who are on the ground, the people who are the activists and protesters who saying enough is enough. We also need our legislative partners to help transform the protest into policy. We need Breonna's law, not just in Louisville, not just in the state of Kentucky, but all throughout the United States of America, because her life matters.
Breonna Taylor's family attorney, Benjamin Crump, speaking Tuesday. Breonna's mother, Tamika Palmer, also responded to the settlement.
As significant as today is, it's only the beginning of getting full justice for Breonna. We must not lose focus on what the real job is. And with that being said, it's time to move forward with the criminal charges, because she deserves that and much more. Her beautiful spirit and personality is working through all of us on the ground. So please continue to say her name, Breonna Taylor.
Joining Breonna Taylor's family, their lawyer, and the mayor at Tuesday's press conference was activist Tamika Mallory.
A settlement is restitution, but it's not arresting the cops. And we want to say today that the police officers responsible for killing Breonna Taylor must be arrested in order for the community to feel calm. Breonna Taylor has shifted the atmosphere. She shifted it not just here in Kentucky, but across the country. The ban on no-knock warrants was where we begin in terms of great reform. The officers, Brett Hankinson, Miles Cosgrove, John Mattingly, and Joshua James must be arrested. We cannot forget about Joshua James, the man who lied on a no-knock warrant application that sent police officers charging into the home of Breonna Taylor and Kenny Walker. We cannot forget about any of those officers. And if this police department is to do right by this community, if you know of other officers who were involved, they should be arrested and indicted immediately.
That was Tamika Mallory speaking at Tuesday's news conference for Breonna Taylor, whose family will receive $12 million in a settlement with the city of Louisville. When we come back, we'll get response from journalist and author Michael Denzel Smith, and we'll also talk about the upcoming presidential election and his new book, Stakes is High, Life After the American Dream. Stay with us. How Deep is the Ocean by Charlie Parker. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. We're joined now by Michael Denzel Smith to discuss the historic settlement the city of Louisville has just reached with Breonna Taylor's family, the upcoming presidential election, and far more. Michael Denzel Smith is a fellow at Tite Media Center, author of Invisible Man, Got the Whole World Watching, A Young Black Man's Education, and his new book, just released this week, Stakes is High, Life After the American Dream. One of its essays was adapted for an op-ed this week in the New York Times headlined, A Biden Win Won't Cure My Trump-Era Depression. Michael Denzel Smith, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. Let's start with the Breonna Taylor settlement in Louisville. We just heard Benjamin Crump, as well as Breonna's mother and Tamika Mallory, talking about this record $12 million settlement to the family and police reform in Louisville, though the police officers who killed Breonna Taylor have not been arrested. Your response?
I hope that this settlement brings Breonna Taylor's family some semblance of peace. I hope that this helps in mitigating their pain and helping them heal together. But I think we have to dispense with the notion that there is justice for Breonna Taylor at this point. There is no justice in her lost life. There is no justice in arresting and indicting and convicting the officers who killed her. Because what we're doing then is relying on a system that is built to inscribe injustice in our society, to deliver justice, that the idea that prison would be a just result. No, what the system can do right now is enact a sense of revenge by inflicting harm on the officers who killed Breonna Taylor. And look, her family is well within their rights to want that right now, and I will never question that. But what I can say, or what I want the rest of us to think through, is the idea that what the community needs in response to the killing of Breonna Taylor, what the nation needs in the response to the killing of Breonna Taylor, is the arrest of these individual officers. The only way to prevent another instance of the killing that the situation that took Breonna Taylor's life, it's to defund, dismantle police departments across the nation, across the world, abolishing police, abolishing the very idea of policing. setting up a new organizing principle for our society that would wouldn't require policing in the first place. You know, what we're looking at there, I mean, the settlement is huge, but the idea of public money subsidizing black death is nothing new. This is routine, and they're willing to pay this amount of money in order to continue the system. You know, police are going to kill again over 1,000 people every year, and they'd be willing to pay $12 million for each of those if that means that they can go about their business continuing to do that. What I think we have to understand is that it's a structural problem. And some of these reforms that they've offered here in response, I mean, it's great that they're thinking in that way, that they're, in addition to the monetary settlement, they're asking for things to change within the police department. But the things that they've asked for, I mean, the things that they've won here in terms of police officers needing to be parts of their community and live in the communities that they're policing, well, that just means that police are going to kill their neighbors. Now, the idea that, you know, we need more oversight from higher ups within the police departments. What do we think is going to happen? Do we think that police chiefs have more compassion? That police chiefs have more wisdom to pass down, or more ideas around eliminating violence from their communities? These aren't things that are going to change the fundamental nature of policing, or eliminate the reasons for policing in the first place. So I think we just have to understand that there's no justice here. Justice needs to be conceptualized as something that is more proactive, that is about providing people with the things that they need for a sustainable life while they're here, and that we can't think that justice means monetary compensation for black death.
Michael Denzel Smith, I wanted to ask you, Benjamin Crump at the press conference yesterday put a lot of stress on this whole issue of reforms of what's the so-called no-knock warrants. These were mm-hmm. actually products of the 1980s Reagan war on drugs. In the early 1980s, there were about 1,500 no-knock warrants by law enforcement across the country. Today, there are 60 to 70,000 a year. Do you think that this will have any significant impact, this whole idea of that there are no constitutional rights for people who are accused of or suspected of any kind of illegal activity, that police can just break down their door?
Yeah, I mean, James Baldwin was writing about no-knock warrants in the 60s, and Gil Scott-Heron, again, in the 70s, talking about these no-knock warrants, the ability of police to simply go into any home that they please without cause, break down doors and arrest people, shoot people. I mean, the idea of the warrant in and of itself being something that we require in these instances points to the fact that people have no rights to begin with, right? Because even if you require the warrant, police find ways around that or develop systems that then don't require them to have warrants in the first place. There's no warrant required, there wasn't a warrant required for stop and frisk here in New York City, right? But we found justifications, or the city found justifications for being able to implement that program. So again, I think, you know, there's the specifics, right? There's the things that are very clearly are harmful, and no-knock warrants are something that we absolutely have to address here. But that's part of a structural problem in which what police are sent out to do in these instances is to enforce these laws that are meant to subjugate segments of the population.
And in terms of the role that the protest movement across the country has had, and the activists in Kentucky specifically, in terms of forcing, we're increasingly seeing police departments and cities have to respond. The Rochester situation where the mayor fires the police chief this week. What is your assessment of the impact of the movement on trying to get some structural changes?
there won't be any structural changes without movement. And I think we have to acknowledge that a huge reason why these changes are taking place in the first place is that it's not just that people are in the streets, it's not just that people are demanding these things, it's that they've taken radical action. They have taken militant action. They've directly confronted state power. If nothing happens, the protest movement doesn't grow to the size that it did even this past summer. If it weren't for the fact that in the beginning of this, that police station was burned in Minneapolis, right? That police cars were set on fire in New York, in Atlanta, in Louisville. We have to understand that the property destruction as a tactic was used, and it set the nation on notice that something has to change now. And so the thing that that gives me hope is that, you know, these things are possible. But what makes me have questions around is how much more of that is going to be necessary if what we've won in the aftermath of that, of such dramatic action, is these very milquetoast and middle of the road reforms.
Michael, your op-ed piece in the New York Times that just appeared, "A Biden Win Won't Cure My Trump Era Depression," adapted from your new book, Stakes Is High. You begin by talking about the killing of your 12-year-old, when you were 12 years old, the killing of your cousin, and the effect it has on the family, on the community. Share that personal story with us and then take it bigger.
Well, I think, you know, the acknowledgement there was that, you know, there's community violence that does impact us on a deeply emotional level. As a 12-year-old, losing a big cousin of mine who was 17 at the time had an impact that I didn't acknowledge at that time. But it did set off a chain of events in which I experienced depression every year. And so I was diagnosed with this, an anxiety disorder, later in my life. But the piece is about the ways in which, like, the outside forces contribute to that level of depression. It's something that I wouldn't have, even as someone who has lived with depression, wouldn't have acknowledged as depression during the past 4 years of the Trump era, until very late in this time, because I wasn't acknowledging that it had any impact on me personally. But what I'm pointing to in that piece is that many people are feeling the anxiety of this era. And I think we have to note it, that part of it is coming off of 8 years of the first Black presidency, and for the limitations of it, and there were many, it was an era in which people felt like there was some type of avenue toward progress. The election of Donald Trump is a retrenchment of the forces of white supremacist, heteropatriarchal capitalism that are grinding to people to an early death during an era in which we have very little time to face the climate apocalypse, as we see the fires raging out in California and the Pacific Northwest, and the hurricanes gathering in the Gulf Coast during a global pandemic of an airborne illness. We think we just don't have very much time to address this. And 4 years of a Trump presidency has only done anything to accelerate the climate disaster here. So what we're facing is an idea that we're depressed, and I am depressed because it seems so large. It seems too big to handle, and that, you know, the response from the Democratic Party, the party that's supposed to be in opposition to everything that is happening now, was to nominate for president Joe Biden, who has a nearly 50-year history of public service, in which we can acknowledge or identify that he's mostly been a conservative ideologue, that he has staked out positions to the right of the Republican Party in many instances. And that doesn't give me much room to feel like we are shifting in any significant way to the transformative things that we need to address the large problems that we're facing, the existential crisis that we are facing globally. So it's to say, you know, yes, Donald Trump must be ousted from office, and that is whether or not he wins the election or not, whether or not he cheats his way toward winning the election or wins it legitimately, or he is voted out of office. In any of these instances, there are things that are going to have to be done that are bigger than Donald Trump, that are bigger than Joe Biden. We have to... There has to be collective movement toward facing the large-scale crises that we are up against now.
I wanted to get clear on something. In your essay, you do talk about this, what many psychologists have said, that there is actually an increasing mental health problem in the United States since Trump became president. Some even name it, as you say in your article, Trump anxiety disorder. But you're saying at the same time that you don't think that there'll be any substantial or a measurable difference in terms of if Biden is successful in coming to office?
Well, the problem is that there could be there'll be some movement, of course. Like, there will be jubilation if in certain segments of America if Joe Biden is elected president. Absolutely. But what I'm saying is that after Joe Biden is elected president in that scenario, the problems that we face are still going to be in front of us. And what Joe Biden has offered thus far is not a transformative enough agenda to be able to face those issues. And so what I'm saying is that, yeah, like, the Trump part of that may be settled, but the rest of it, the things that are fundamental to the nature of American empire, the things that are fundamental to the nature of American capitalism, white supremacy, all of those institutions, the structural problems, the ideology undergirding that keeps oppression in place, those things are still there, and that we haven't then elected a president that will be willing to confront those things. And so the depression part of that could still sink in because, again, what we're up against, what we're facing, I mean, these fires are not going to stop. Like, the things that we're up against are just not going to abate just because Joe Biden's been elected president. And I think, you know, we have to acknowledge that, yes, the Trump part of it could be settled by November, but the rest of it is could potentially cause another depression.
Well, Michael Denzel Smith, we want to thank you for being with us. We're going to do part two of our conversation after the show and post it online at democracynow.org. Michael is Tate Media Center Fellow, author of Invisible Man, Got the Whole World Watching, A Young Black Man's Education. His new book, just released, Stakes is High, Life After the American Dream. We'll link to several of your essays, one in The Atlantic and the other in The New York Times. Its headline, A Biden Win Won't Cure My Trump-Era Depression. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, the U.S.-brokered Bahrain-UAE-Israel deal that was signed at the White House yesterday. Stay with us. White Willow by Nizar Rahana. This is Democracy Now!, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Israel signed a U.S. broker deal to normalize relations with the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain. They're the first Arab countries to normalize relations with Israel in over a quarter of a century. President Trump presided over the White House ceremony with the three countries on Tuesday.
This is peace in the Middle East without blood all over the sand. I say it.
Right now, it's been blood all over the sand for decades and decades and decades. That's all they do is they fight and kill people, and nobody gets anything.
After Trump spoke with reporters in the Oval Office alongside Netanyahu, he spoke to a crowd of several hundred people on the White House lawn, most of them sitting in close proximity without face masks. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu joined Trump for the ceremony.
This day is a pivot of history. It heralds a new dawn of peace. For thousands of years, the Jewish people have prayed for peace. For decades, the Jewish state has prayed for peace. And this is why today we're filled with such profound gratitude.
Neither Netanyahu nor Trump mentioned the Palestinians in their remarks. Earlier in the day, Palestinian activists in the West Bank and Gaza protested the agreements. The foreign ministers of Bahrain and the UAE also spoke at the ceremony. Emirati Foreign Minister Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed also spoke. For more, we're joined by Noura Erekat, Palestinian human rights attorney, legal scholar, assistant professor at Rutgers University, author of Justice for Some, Law and the Question of Palestine. Her new piece for NBC News headlined, Trump peace deals for Israel, UAE and Bahrain are shams. They boost oppression, not amity. Welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us, Noura. If you can talk about—I mean, yesterday the word historic was repeated over and over again by the Gulf State foreign ministers, as well as Trump and Netanyahu. You have very different feelings about this agreement.
I do. Thank you for having me, Amy. I think this is really important to, you know, it's a reminder for us that Palestine does not exist in isolation, but is part of the Middle East, is part of an entire region. And what we're seeing in these agreements is basically the U.S. expanding and entrenching its sphere of influence within the Middle East by aligning explicitly its relationship with Israel, the United Arab Emirates, and Bahrain. There has been no war between these countries. There were no hostilities. The reason that the Emirates and Bahrain have withheld normalizing their relationship with Israel was merely to withhold a carrot that would otherwise incentivize Israel to make enduring concessions to the Palestinians for their Palestinian national rights. Given that Israel is the only nuclear superpower in the Middle East, as well as the 11th most powerful military in the world against a Palestinian people without an army or an airport, these kinds of carrots and incentives are otherwise necessary. The fact that they have now offered this carrot without any meaningful concession to the Palestinians, even slightly easing the blockade on Gaza, should indicate to us that this is not about advancing any kind of meaningful, enduring peace, but instead about entrenching a geopolitical alliance that would otherwise increase oppression for people of the Middle East in Bahrain, in the Emirates, in Yemen, and in Palestine, who are struggling for freedom and democracy and are now facing off against powers who are backed by the United States militarily and also offered impunity within international fora like the Security Council.
And Noura, I'm wondering, there's so much attention has been placed on these agreements, and yet both the Emirates and Bahrain, to some extent, there might be real questions as to whether they even represent their own, the leaders represent their own populations. I mean, the UAE, 9 out of 10 people who live in the UAE aren't even Emiratis. They are largely South Asians, Bangladeshis, Pakistanis, Filipinos, who have been brought in as migrant workers and now are the 9/10 of the population. Likewise, in Bahrain, something like 40%, 45% of the population is not are not natives of the country. So these are basically countries that didn't even exist independently when Israel occupied the West Bank. They gained their independence from England in 1971. So to what degree are they representative of the rest of the Arab world?
You're rightly highlighting the lack of Democratic representation and leadership. It is why we have seen the Arab street rise up in what's been known as the Arab uprising across the Arab world. And we've now seen, obviously, the counter-revolutionary trend against them backed by the United States. In response to those who like to mythologize and pathologize Arabs as not ready for democracy or unable to govern themselves, this actually helps reveal the truth, which is that democracy, people governing themselves, is suppressed because of outside forces like the United States, who are supporting regimes who are more indebted to them and more accountable to those regimes, who are providing it with aid or who are providing it with some sort of military protection rather than accountability to their base. The fact that in Bahrain, what we have seen in recent years, that we saw an uprising in 2011 of the population demanding an elected parliament, demanding a new constitution, and they were met with lethal force, after which they began demanding the fall of the Al-Khalifa monarchy. It was Saudi Arabia and the UAE that supported them and suppressing those democracy protests. We are now seeing Bahrain continue their trend to suppress the protests by now having the support of the United States to protect them from any kind of international accountability, and on the ground with brute military force. They have a lot in common with Israel. And what this should reveal to us is not a peace, but a deal that brings together these forces who are aligned in suppressing populations, in suppressing movements for freedom and democracy, and should make more clear to us why Palestinians and the rest of the Arab world are actually sharing in a singular fate. Palestine does not exist in a vacuum. It is why Palestinians have understood that the road to Jerusalem or the pathway to freedom flows through other Arab capitals, and that is as true today as it has been historically.
This is the UAE Foreign Minister Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed.
I stand here today to extend a hand of peace and receive a hand of peace. In our faith, we say, O God, you are peace, and from you comes peace. The search for peace is an innate principle, yet principles are effectively realized when they are transformed into action. Today, we are already witnessing a change in the heart of the Middle East, a change that will send hope around the world.
The foreign minister of UAE was speaking in Arabic with English translation over him. Bahrain's foreign minister, Abdellatif Al Zayani, spoke in English.
Today's agreement is an important first step, and it is now incumbent on us to work urgently and actively to bring about the lasting peace and security our peoples deserve. A just, comprehensive, and enduring two-state solution to the Palestinian-Israeli conflict will be the foundation, the bedrock of such peace.
So, Nour Erekat, President Trump says he thinks at least five other countries are going to sign on, and there's a lot of speculation about what they will get, Bahrain being Saudi Arabia's toe in the water here, testing the waters. You have Sudan, and the question is, would the U.S. take Sudan off the terror list in exchange for Sudan signing on? Morocco, the possibility, some speculation that the U.S. would be the first in the world to recognize Morocco's sovereignty over Western Sahara. And of course, we know that UAE, Jared Kushner, also admitting that making a deal to give them F-37s, something they haven't been able to get for years from the United States, the U.S. weaponry, the jets. Your thoughts?
I think you're highlighting what's true. Instead of discussing this as a peace process, instead, what's happening with these countries is that they're entering into agreements that are brokered by global superpower in order to advance and achieve their own political interests, whether it be to normalize occupation in the Western Sahara, whether it be to normalize their oppression over their populations, their own populations. What is clear is that none of it has to do with advancing peace. None of it has to do with Palestinians. The reason that Arab states have withheld normalization, as I've mentioned, is in order to provide an incentive to Israel to recognize and concede to some Palestinian national rights. Bahrain is now the fourth Arab country to normalize relationships. Now it now includes Egypt, Jordan, the UAE, and Bahrain. None of these agreements have ensured a single enduring concession on behalf of Palestinian national rights, not the easing of the blockade, not the end of the occupation, not even the lifting of the apartheid wall. There have been no concessions. And so what's being dutifully and deliberately left off out of this picture is the fact that the only peace that is necessary is that between Israel and the Palestinians, who they occupy, over whom they maintain an apartheid regime. There are no hostilities with these other countries, and yet that is being framed as peace for us in order to obscure this reality of state oppression and ongoing violence.
I meant F-35s, not F-37s, that UAE are going to get. It's also the anniversary, 1993, of the Oslo Accords and the significance of this, Noor Arakat.
Again, this is an opportunity to revisit that history. The 1993 Declaration of Principles never promised a Palestinian state. There was no promise for a two-state solution, and that needs to be clear. Israel has been a state since 1948 and has been recognized by Palestinians as a state in 1988 and again in 1993. There is nothing in the Declaration of Principles that even promises that the outcome of it will lead to an independent Palestinian state, and yet that is what has been sold to us. Instead, this is an autonomy agreement for permanent derivative sovereignty, whereby Palestinians can live in Bantustans and reservations with the blessing of Israel, but never as a people, never with national independence. The 1993 Declaration of Principles, Oslo, in my eyes, has been dead since the besiegement of Yasser Arafat in the presidential compound in Ramallah in 2001 and his death in 2002. And yet we continue on with the farce of the peace process now into 2020. And the responsibility for that lies squarely on the official Palestinian leadership. This is a moment of accountability. Unless the Palestinian leadership can look at this record and account for where they failed to take opportunities, what junctures they did not turn on, what moments they did not reassess this failed strategy, there is no moving forward with them in any kind of capacity as representative of the Palestinian people. If nothing else, this is a moment of reckoning to understand and to deliberate about a radical rethinking about the Palestinian movement for freedom. And Palestinians the world over have been doing that work as they overcome and surmount diplomatic intransigence to advance the Palestinian cause for freedom through campaigns like boycott, divestment, and sanctions, which has in effect kept the Palestinian struggle alive, created new alliances across the globe. It's why we see solidarity protests in Pretoria, South Africa. It's why we see now members of Congress who are standing up to explain that this is not about democracy, peace, and freedom. That's precisely because there has been a shadow Palestinian movement in place of the Palestinian official leadership. And hopefully we'll see more of that as we move along, where the base is mobilizing the top.
Noor, I wanted to ask you, we have just about a minute left, but what about this claim of the United Arab Emirates that this deal was part of the agreement was part of an exchange for Israel suspending plans to annex a large swath of the occupied West Bank? What's your reaction to that claim?
I think that's a joke. I think that's an absolute joke. It was because of the international reaction to Israel's annexation plans that they did not find it in their interest. We also saw a tremendous amount of opposition from U.S. Congress. And in fact, for Israel, it's more of the same, because they already exercise de facto annexation over those lands. What it would have advanced and would have changed for Israelis is the fact that Netanyahu would have been playing to his right-wing base, that he was able to secure annexation during his tenure. But the reality on the ground doesn't change. This doesn't avert the takeover of those lands. If the UAE actually wanted to make a meaningful concession for Palestinians, it would have been withdrawal of Israeli troops from the Jordan Valley, at the very least, which is only 30% of the West Bank, let alone withdrawal from the entire occupied territories, and in fact, the right of return for Palestinian refugees. This leaves so much for want, and all of it is doublespeak and mirrors and shadows when they say that there are any meaningful concessions. We'll probably see Israel advance their interests and actually enact de jure annexation, notwithstanding this agreement.
Noor Erekat, we want to thank you so much for being with us, Palestinian human rights attorney and legal scholar. We'll link to her piece, Trump Peace Deals for Israel, UAE, and Bahrain Are Shams. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.